Hello friends, welcome back to another important video. This is 7th mock test of GIB series, and if you have missed the earlier mock test, then please check the links for those in the description to this video. In this mock test, we will cover some very important questions from Accounting and Finance for Bankers paper. Please note all the questions and case studies are very important, and we have selected all these based on recent IIBF trends. So it's my request not to miss even a single question from this mock test. Now before starting, if you haven't subscribed our channel, then do it now. Since this is the only quality channel available on YouTube, and we work very hard to bring the best content for all the aspirants. Also join our Facebook group, which is specifically for all the bankers. We post many useful content from time to time, so do join after you finish this video. Now those of you who have missed our 1000 series of accounting, you can now access the questions on our mobile app also. All the links are there in description to this video. So let's start with our mock test. Now the first question is from module D, that is banking operations. And the question goes like this. You are handling clearing operation of your branch. What return reason will you attach for the following checks? First one is OD limit of an account is Rs 1 lakh. And around Rs 80,000 have already been overdrawn. And then check of another Rs 50,000 hits the account. Then the instrument will be returned for the reason dash. And second one is, a savings bank account has a clear balance of Rs 1 lakh, whereas instrument is issued for Rs 2 lakhs. Then the instrument will be returned for the reason dash. And friends, options are these. Now friends, please note that the reason exceeds arrangement is typically used to mean insufficient funds in an account where the account has been given some credit facilities like cash credit or overdraft. So for this question, the answer to first part will be exceeds arrangement, since this part talks about the overdraft limit in an account. While for second part, the remark for return will be insufficient funds, since account is simply a savings account. So in short, just remember, when balance is not there for savings or current account, the return reason will be insufficient funds, and for CC and OD, the return reason will be exceeds arrangement. So the correct option for this question is option A. Second question is, which of the following is not a contingent liability? And the options are, first option is claims against the company not acknowledged as debts. Then second option is guarantees given in respect of third parties. Then third option is liabilities in respect of bills dishonored. Then last option D is penalty imposed by GST officer for violation of provision of GST Act. Now friends, please note, a contingent liability is a loss which will be known only on the occurrence or non-occurrence of one or more future uncertain events. Thus, in this question, if you look at point D, the penalty is imposed by GST officer for violation of provision of GST Act is a current liability and needs to be paid within a year. And thus, it's not a contingent liability. So the correct option for this question is option D. Now friends, before moving forward, you can also access our 1000 series, which have been made specifically to streamline your GIB preparations and make your task of cracking GIB a lot easy. Also access our GIB secret sauce, which will help you in covering your GIB syllabus a lot faster, since all the topics are in point-wise manner and we have covered all the important part in single book. All the links are there in description to this video, so don't miss out on these. Let's move forward with our mock test. Next question is, a debt to equity ratio is, and the options are, first option is about the same as the debt to asset ratio. Then second option B is higher than the debt to assets ratio. Then third option is lower than the debt to assets ratio. Then last option D is not correlated with debt to asset ratio. And last option D is not correlated with debt to assets ratio. Now friends, as you already know, assets equals debt plus equity. So just look here, a debt to equity ratio will look like this, that is debt upon equity. Now, debt to assets ratio will look like debt upon assets. We have already learned assets equals debt plus equity. So, simply replace assets equals debt plus equity. So, debt to assets ratio will look like debt divided by debt plus equity. Now, you can clearly see a debt to equity ratio will have a lower denominator than a debt to assets ratio. Thus, the debt to equity ratio will be higher than debt to assets ratio. So, the correct option for this question is option B. Next question is, the following data is given, that is original cost equals rupees 1,26,000, then salvage value is given as rupees 6,000, then useful life is given as 6 years. Now the annual depreciation under straight line method, that is SLM, will be, and the options are these. Now friends, fixed installment or straight line method depreciates cost evenly throughout the useful life of the fixed asset. So in straight line method, depreciation is calculated using the relation. Depreciation per annum will be cost minus residual value and whole of this divided by useful life. In this formula, cost includes the initial and any subsequent capital expenditure. Then residual value is the estimated scrap value at the end of useful life of the asset. Now friends, since the residual value is expected to be recovered at the end of an asset's useful life, there is no need to charge the portion of cost equaling the residual value. Finally, useful life is the estimated period an asset is expected to be used from the time it is available for use to the time of its disposal or termination of use. Now in our question, cost of asset is given as rupees 1,26,000. Salvage value is given as rupees 6,000. So depreciation per year will be 1,26,000 minus 6,000 and whole of this divided by 6, which comes out to be rupees 20,000. So the correct answer for the question is option B. Now friends, before moving forward, don't forget to access your free resources ebook, which will guide you in your GIB preparations. We have made this ebook specially for all GIB and DBF aspirants who are not sure how to start their GIB preparations and thus reach the ultimate target. Download this free ebook from the link provided in description. If you do not find, then please comment on this video. We will send you the download link again. Let's move forward with our mock test. Next question is, which of the following statements is false? And the first statement is, expenses in connection with obtaining a license for running the multiplex is capital expenditure. Then second option B is, heavy advertisement expenses to introduce a new product is deferred revenue expenditure. Then third option C is, cost of construction of building including cost of temporary huts for storing building material is a capital expenditure. Then third option D is, the cost of rings and pistons of an engine changed to increase its fuel efficiency is revenue expenditure. Now friends, here please note, any expenditure which has the effect of increasing the efficiency of a machine is termed as capital expenditure. Thus, when you look at option D and relate with this definition, the cost of rings and pistons of an engine changed to increase its fuel efficiency is a capital expenditure and not revenue expenditure. Hope you understand the reasoning of all the other options. If you face any difficulty, feel free to ask in comment section. Next question is from module D, that is banking operations. In November 2018, Supreme Court restricted the use of Aadhaar card for bank KYC process. But there are at least two exceptions where, according to UIDAI, financial institutions can still use Aadhaar card. Which of the following are those two exceptional cases? And the first option is for getting subsidy into bank account. Then second option is for facilitating the withdrawal of money through Aadhaar based micro ATM machines. Then third option is both A and B. And last option D is only A. Now friends, after the Supreme Court judgment in 2018, that restricted all private entities including banks against the use of Aadhaar for customer identification or KYC service, the UIDAI has given clear instructions to all the banks that the Aadhaar cannot be used to open the bank account. However, there are two cases where the UIDAI has said banks can still use Aadhaar for the customer verification. Now, first of those is for getting the subsidy into bank account. Now, if you want money from any government subsidy like that for LPG connections or any other welfare scheme to be transferred directly to your bank account, then the bank may still seek the Aadhaar number, because according to Supreme Court, Aadhaar is must for availing subsidies through direct benefit transfer schemes. Now, in a letter to banks, the UIDAI had made it clear that the banks can use Aadhaar eKYC to authenticate beneficiaries of government subsidies and welfare schemes. Besides this, banking institutions have also been allowed to use Aadhaar for facilitating the withdrawal of money through Aadhaar-based micro ATM machines. This means the Aadhaar-enabled payment system, that is AEPS, friends, please remember this short form, and Bheem Aadhaar Pay shall remain operative, and banks can continue to maintain and provide these facilities so that direct benefit transfer beneficiaries can withdraw money through micro ATMs, AEPS, and Bheem Aadhaar Pay. So friends, the correct option for this question is option C. Now friends, before moving ahead, I would like to share other lectures which you must watch after this class. Some of those are Ratio Analysis Masterclass and Depreciation Masterclass. Both these topics come heavily in accounting paper. Moreover, these are easy to master for non-commerce candidates. The same is for Forex Masterclass. Do watch this Forex lecture also. We have another mock test on accounting, so access all these important classes from the links provided in description to this video. Let's move forward with our lecture. Next question is from Module C, that is Final Accounts. Following is the trading account of a firm. Answer next two questions based on this data. The first question is, the inventory turnover ratio for the firm is, and the options given are these. Now friends, inventory turnover ratio is cost of goods sold divided by average stock. In short, we also write it as COGS. It's equal to opening stock plus purchases plus carriage plus wages minus closing stock. Now this will be equals to ₹60,000 plus 2,50,000 plus 20,000 plus 58,000 minus 68,000. On solving this, you will get 3,20,000. Now let's find average stock. Now average stock will be 60,000 plus 68,000 divided by 2, that is ₹64,000. Hope you got how we find this average stock. Finally, let's substitute all these values in the formula of inventory turnover ratio. So inventory turnover ratio will be ₹3,20,000 divided by ₹64,000. That is 5 times. So friends, the correct option for this question is option A. Next question is, average age of inventory for the firm is, and the options given are these. Now friends, average age of the inventory is simply days in a year divided by inventory turnover ratio. Now inventory turnover ratio we have already found in the last question. So average age of the inventory will be simply 365 divided by 5, that is 73 days. So the correct option for this question is option C. Now friends, inventory age of 73 days implies that on an average the money blocked in inventory gets converted into sales in 73 days. So if the inventory turnover ratio goes up, the average age of inventory will go down and vice versa. Next question is from Module D, that is Banking Operations, and the question goes like this. Inward clearing difference could arise in which one of the following ways? First option is checks listed to the bank or branch but not received by it, that is the clearing receivables. Then second option is checks received by the bank or branch but not debited by it, that is the clearing payables. Then option C is checks received by the bank or branch with the actual debit not tallying with the face value of the instrument. And last option D is all of the above. Now friends, generally there are two types of clearing differences that may arise. First one is inward clearing differences and second one is outward clearing differences. Let's see each one in detail. First one is inward clearing differences, which is basically of three types. First one is checks listed to the bank or branch but not received by it. These are also called the clearing receivables. Then second is checks received by the bank or branch but not debited to it. These are also called clearing payables. And then third is checks received by the bank or branch with the actual debit not tallying with the face value of the instrument. Then on the other hand, we have outward clearing differences that could arise in any one of the following ways. First one is no credit received in respect of an instrument presented. Then second is short credit received in respect of an instrument presented. Then third is excess credit received in respect of an instrument presented. Then fourth one is credit received in excess of the claim. Now friends, please remember these outward clearing differences also, as question may be asked from this also. So friends, the correct answer with respect to our question is option D. Next question is from module C, that is final accounts, and the question goes like this. The current assets of Monarch Company is ₹29,745 and current ratio is 1.5. The inventory stood at ₹8,827. Now the liquid ratio of the company is, and the options given are these. Now friends, liquid ratio is calculated as liquid assets divided by current liabilities. So our task is to calculate liquid assets and current liabilities. Now liquid assets equals current assets minus inventories. Now it will be 29,745 minus 8,827, which will be ₹20,918. Now let's find current liabilities. Now we are given current ratio and it's equals to current assets divided by current liabilities, that is 1.5, which is given, equals ₹29,745. This is also given, that is current assets are also given, and this divided by current liabilities. Now on solving this, you will get current liabilities equals ₹29,745 divided by 1.5, which equals ₹19,830. Finally, substituting both these values in formula for liquid ratio, we get liquid ratio equals 20,918 divided by 19,830, which equals approximately 1.05:1. So friends, the correct option for this question is option B. Let's move on to next question. Next question is from module D, that is banking operations. And the question is, which of the following are acceptable KYC documents in case of trust? And the options given are these. Here friends, please note valid KYC documents for trust are, first is entity proof and address proof documents of the entity. Then second is trust deed signed by at least two managing or authorized trustees. Then third is certificate of registration with registrar of trusts or deputy or assistant charity commissioner or PF commissioner in case of PF trust. Then fourth is PAN card in name of trust. Then fifth is certified copy of resolution of open or maintaining the bank account signed by the chairperson or secretary or two authorized signatories. Then last one is trust declaration. So friends, as you can see, the correct option for given question is option D. Next question is, Z invests ₹10,000 every year starting from today for next 10 years. Suppose interest rate is 8% per annum compounded annually, the future value of the annuity will be. It's also given that 1 plus 0.08 raised to the power 10 equals 2.1589. And the options given are these. Now friends, this question is a question of annuity due, and as you all know that in annuity due or annuity immediate, first received or payment is made today. While annuity regular assumes that the first receipt or the first payment is made at the end of first period. Now, the relationship between the value of an annuity due and an ordinary annuity in case of future value is, future value of an annuity due or annuity immediate equals future value of annuity regular multiplied by 1 plus I, where I is the interest rate in decimal. So, for calculating the future value of annuity due, it involves two steps. In step 1, simply calculate the future value as though it is an ordinary annuity. Then in step 2, multiply the result by 1 plus I. So, let's apply this to the given question. So, in step 1, we will calculate future value as though it was an ordinary annuity, which will be rupees 10,000 multiplied by 1 plus 0.08 raised to the power 10 minus 1 divided by 0.08. On solving this, you will get rupees 10,000 multiplied by 14.4865. Please note we are already given the value of 1 plus 0.08 raised to the power 10, that is 2.1589. So on solving this, you will get rupees 1,44,865.625. Now in step 2, multiply the result by 1 plus I, that is rupees 1,44,865.625 multiplied by 1 plus 0.08. Now on solving this, you will get rupees 1,56,454.875. So as you can see, the correct answer for this question is option A. Let's move on to next question. Alpha Limited purchased a machinery on April 1st, 2012 for rupees 3 lakhs. It is estimated that the machinery will have a useful life of 5 years, after which it will have no salvage value. If the company follows some of the year's digits method of depreciation, the amount of depreciation charge during the year 2016-17 will be, and the options are these. Now friends, sum of the years of digits method is a variation of the reducing balance method. In this case, the annual depreciation is calculated by multiplying the original cost of the asset less its estimated scrap value by a fraction. And the fraction is calculated as the sum of the years including the present year of the remaining life of the asset and whole of this divided by total of all digits of the life of the asset, and that too in years. Now suppose the estimated life of an asset is 10 years. So the total of all the digits from 1 to 10 is 55. That is 10 plus 9 plus 8 plus 7 plus 6 plus 5 plus 4 plus 3 plus 2 plus 1. On adding these, you will get 55. Now the depreciation to be written off in the first year will be 10 by 55 multiplied by the cost of assets less its estimated scrap value. And the depreciation for the second year will be 9 divided by 55 multiplied by cost of assets less estimated scrap value and so on. Now in the given question, we are only given useful life as 5 years. Now as per this method, for financial year 2016-17, depreciation will be calculated as 3 lakhs multiplied by 1 divided by 15. That is rupees 20,000. So friends, by now, hope you got how we get 1 by 15. 1, that is number of years, including the present year of the remaining life of the asset. And 15 is 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5, that is 15. So friends, the correct option for this question is option D. Next question is, two mutually exclusive projects have the following cash flows and internal rates of return. And this data is given. Assuming a discount rate of 8% annually for both projects, the firm should most likely accept. And the options are, first option is both projects, then second option is project A only, then third option C is project B only, then option D is none. Now friends, to find which project should be accepted, we should first find the NPV, that is net present value of both the projects. Now the NPV of project A will be calculated as minus 2450 plus 345 divided by 1.08 whole to the power 1 plus 849 divided by 1.08 whole to the power 2 plus 635 divided by 1.08 whole to the power 3 plus 3645 divided by 1.08 whole to the power 4. On solving this, you will get 1780.59 lakhs. Now the NPV of project B will be calculated as minus 2450 plus 345 divided by 1.08 whole to the power 1 plus 849 divided by 1.08 whole to the power 2 plus 1051 divided by 1.08 whole to the power 3 plus 3175 divided by 1.08 whole to the power 4. On solving this, you will get 1765.36 lakhs. Now friends, here comes the very interesting part of this question and also very important concept. Just notice, IRR of project A is less than IRR of project B, but NPV of project A is greater than NPV of project B. So friends, please remember, whenever an NPV and IRR conflict arises, you should always accept the project with higher NPV. So for this question, option B is correct because project A has higher NPV, and since the projects are mutually exclusive, so only project A should be accepted. Next question is, if the stated annual interest rate is 20% and the frequency of compounding is monthly, the effective annual rate, that is EAR, is closest to, and the options given are these. Now friends, the effective annual rate, that is EAR, is calculated as 1 plus periodic interest rate whole to the power n minus 1. In this question, the periodic interest rate will be 0.20 divided by 12 since it's compounded monthly, which comes out to be 0.01667. So the effective annual rate will be 1 plus 0.01667 whole to the power 12 minus 1. On solving this, you will get 0.219369, or approximately in percentage, it will be 22%. Now, since we have to find the annual rate for 1 year only, that's why we have used the power 12. So the correct option for this question is option C. Next question is from module A from the topic foreign exchange. And the question is, the current spot rate for the USD euro is 0.7500. The forward rate for the euro Australian dollar is 1.4300, which represents a 400 point forward premium to the spot rate, which is scaled up by 4 decimal places. The USD Australian dollar spot rate is closest to, and the options given are these. Now friends, please note here that these rates are only used for the example purpose and the question purpose only. Please don't compare these rates with the present prevailing rates. Now in one of the previous mock tests and also in our 1000 series, I received some comments from 2-3 aspirants that the rates used by you are not the current prevailing or actual rates. Now friends, these rates change every hour or every day. So practically when you watch this video, you may find the rates which are different from these rates. The question we have framed is just for the example purpose, so that you learn the concept and learn how to solve this particular question when it comes in your examination. Now friends, forex questions are very easy and also scoring. So don't miss out on these high scoring questions, especially science or non-commerce graduates. So for this question, our first step is to find the spot rate for the euro Australian dollar, since we are given forward rate. Now for that, we need to convert it into spot rate. So in step 1, we will find the spot rate for euro Australian dollar. Now spot rate equals forward rate minus premium points, that is 1.4300 minus 400 divided by 10,000, which will be 1.3900. Now we have divided it by 10,000 since it's given in question as scaled up by 4 decimal places. So in step 2, we will calculate the USD Australian dollar using cross rate method. That is, USD Australian dollar can be written as USD upon euro multiplied by euro divided by Australian dollar. Now this euro and euro cancels out and you are ultimately left out with USD Australian dollar. So when you substitute the values of USD Euro and Euro Australian Dollar in this equation, you will get USD upon Australian Dollar equals 0.7500 multiplied by 1.3900, which comes out to be 1.0425. Now those of you who still couldn't understand the explanation, then that must be due to the fact that you haven't read this Forex chapter. So to save time, I would request you to watch our video lecture on foreign exchange. The link is there in description to this video. You will get your foreign exchange concepts crystal clear after watching this lecture. So for this question, the correct answer is option B. Next question is from module B and the topic is accounting concepts. And the question goes like this. On the left side, accounting concepts are given and you need to match them with correct statements to the right. Please pause the video and see the left and the right side of this table carefully and try to match yourself with the correct concepts. And the options given are these. Now friends, to answer all these questions, you must know all these accounting concepts really well. So let's start with the consistency concept. This concept states that accounting practices followed by a firm should be uniform and consistent over a period of time. For example, if a firm has adopted straight line method of charging depreciation, then it has to be followed year after year. If we adopt written down value method for charging depreciation, then the financial information will not be comparable. So the correct option for consistency concept is B. Now let's see money measurement concept. This concept states that transactions and events that can be expressed in money terms are recorded in the books of accounts. Non-monetary transactions cannot be recorded in the books like appointment of manager, capabilities of human resources, etc. Another aspect is the records of transactions are to be kept not in physical unit but in monetary unit. For example, an organization having 3 buildings, 10 computers, 18 office tables are not recorded because they are physical units and not in monetary units. So for this concept, the correct pair is option D. Now let's see business entity concept. This concept assumes that business has a distinct and separate entity from its owners. Therefore, business transactions are recorded in the books of accounts from the business point of view and not owners. For example, if owner brings rupees 1 lakh as capital in business, it will be treated as liability of the business to the owner. Similarly, if owner withdraws 5000 from business for personal use, it is treated as reduction of owner's capital and consequently reduction in liability of business towards owner. So for business entity concept, correct match will be option A. Finally, let's see conservatism concept, which is also known as prudence concept. Now this concept takes into consideration all prospective losses but not prospective profits. It means profit should not be recorded until it is realized, but all losses, even those which have remote possibility, are to be recorded in the books. For example, valuing closing stock at cost or market value, whichever is lower, or creating provision for doubtful debts, etc. Now friends, this concept also ensures that the financial statements provide the real picture of the enterprise. So for conservatism concept, correct pair will be option C, which anyhow is the correct option since it's a left out option. So friends, hope by now you got the correct answer choice for this question, which is option A. Please note, questions like these have started to come in examination. Our 1000 series also contains many questions like these, so do practice well before your examination. Let's do another question like that of previous question. Here also match entries A from column A to column B. Please pause the video and read it carefully. And the options given are these. Now friends, to solve this question, let's see each of these statements one by one. So to solve first statement, please note favorable balance of the cash book implies the debit balance as per cash book and credit balance as per passbook. So the correct pair for first statement is option C. Now let's see the second statement. For this, please remember that bank reconciliation statement is prepared by the customer of the bank on a particular date. And for this, correct pair is option A. Now for third, please remember that bank statement is the copy of the customer's copy in the books of bank. Finally, for fourth, remember that overdraft balance as per passbook equals credit balance as per cashbook and debit balance as per passbook. So the correct pair will be option B. So friends, with this, hope you have got the correct answer choice. The correct answer choice for this question will be option C. Next question is, following data is given for XYZ Limited. Now friends, as you can see, here some balances under various heads is given. Now the total of balance sheet for this firm will be, and the option given are these. Now friends, the balance sheet equation is that the total assets equals total liabilities plus owner's equity. Now looking at the equation in this way shows how assets were financed, either by borrowing money, that is liability, or by using the owner's money, that is owner's or shareholder's equity. Thus, the total of balance sheet will be equal to the total of all assets or total of liabilities plus owner's equity. So for this question, let's calculate the total of balance sheet by way of calculating total assets. Now total assets are cash in hand plus prepaid expenses plus cash at bank plus inventories plus investments plus bill receivables, which equals to 1,24,000 plus 2,000 plus 2,90,000 plus 16,000 plus 2,000 plus 80,000. On solving this, you will get 5,14,000. So the correct option for this question is option A. Now friends, many aspirants are often confused with these entries, especially non-commerce or science graduates. They don't know where to put these various heads under assets or liabilities. Now friends, here you need to just apply the basic logic or think practically while differentiating a head as asset or liability. I basically never remember these heads. I just applied my practical reasoning to analyze and then bifurcate these as assets or liabilities. So just apply your analytical reasoning to differentiate these heads as assets or liabilities. There is no need to remember or mugging up. So friends, finally we have reached the last question of this mock test, and the question goes like this. The working capital turnover ratio from the following data of the firm is, and this data is given, and the options are these. Working capital turnover ratio is simply cost of sales divided by working capital. Now cost of sales or COGS is already given in the data. Now our only task here is to find the working capital. Now working capital will be simply current assets minus current liabilities. Now current assets are stock plus sundry debtors plus marketable securities plus bills receivables plus cash and bank balance. That is 3,60,000 plus 1,40,000 plus 50,000 plus 30,000 plus 20,000. On solving this, you will get rupees 6,000. Now let's calculate current liabilities. Now current liabilities will be sundry creditors plus bills payable plus provision of tax, which is 1,20,000 plus 20,000 plus 10,000, which is 1,50,000. So working capital will be simply current assets minus current liabilities. That is rupees 6 lakh minus rupees 1,50,000. That is rupees 4,50,000. Finally, working capital turnover ratio will be cost of sales divided by working capital. That is rupees 18 lakh divided by rupees 4,50,000. That is approximately it will be 4 times. So friends, the correct answer for this question is option C. So friends, with this I wind up this mock test. Hope all the questions are clear to you. If you feel any difficulty in any question, then feel free to ask your queries in the comment section. I will try to answer all your queries. Finally, you can access all the GIV resources from the links provided in description to this video. Don't miss any of our book, since each of these study material provide comprehensive learning. All the links are there in description to this video. So thank you and all the best for your examinations.